What ideals is it that drives people to do this kind of crap?
Marxism.
Oh. What?
Pushed the button at the wrong time. He forgot it fades out to nothing.
I forgot it faded out to nothing. I could start it over. We could do it again.
And no one would know.
No one would know.
They also wouldn't know that you like to dance provocatively during that song.
I was just showing off my t-shirt.
Is that what you were doing?
I was. It's a beautiful t-shirt.
It's a beautiful t-shirt.
It's my work shirt. For those of you listening on podcast, I'm wearing a beautiful shirt. Says essential AF, and it has a little planet with a road paved on it, and it says pave the planet.
Pave it.
One people, one slab of asphalt.
And my shirt, I feel, is fitting for where we're going with today's society. It's a
and today's show.
It's a welcome to Hawkins shirt, and Hawkins is upside down.
I get it because of.
The upside down.
The upside down.
And the world today is
yes
upside down. Yeah.
I thought it was because the Russians were doing experiments on U.S. soil. Is that not where you were going with that? Oh, okay.
I don't know. At least I don't have a story for that. I
don't have a story for that one.
I do, however, have something.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
What do you have?
Let's go to the
not crabs. I assume
not for a while. No, got them from Joe. Joe's Crab Shack.
Oh,
the look on your face, trying to think how does this work with Vice President Joe Biden?
Wait a minute. This is going directions I'm not really comfortable with anymore.
It took a turn and I wasn't ready.
I tried to make him uncomfortable and he got me. He got me.
Got me. So.
Wow.
We're going to go into the Wayback When machine. Because apparently it's okay to destroy history. Because you disagree with it, or at least you disagree with what you understand about it. Right?
Right.
It seems to be the norm. Mm-hmm. I do enjoy the Seattle mayor finally admitting it's probably not going to be a summer of love in Seattle.
Yeah.
I think a lot of that has to do with... I would be willing to bet that herself and her... cohorts probably thought, I'm sure Donald Trump will come in and do something because he's a dictator like that.
And when he does, we can use the media to defame him like yeah, we usually do.
Because that would be a great image for presidential campaign of president sends in military troops to attack people in a city. And
yeah. Military deployed on U.S. soil shoots black person.
Yeah.
See the headline already.
Yep. And whether Trump intended to or not, called their bluff, and now they're sitting there like,
How exactly do we fix this now?
That has absolutely nothing to do with, well, it does, but it doesn't have anything to do with I'm about to share.
You know, the sad part about that is now they are sending in the police to take care of it. Like
the police that said it wasn't their decision to back out.
Right, yeah. I mean, I don't know about you, but if I was... you know, the police commissioner in that area, I'd be like, no, you politicians go in and you deal with it.
It's the same kind of argument with like, when they talk about getting rid of banning firearms and stuff.
Because you know that this is going to go sideways and the police are going to get the blame for whatever happens. Mm-hmm. Like,
yeah. See how brutal they are?
See how out of control monsters they are.
It's a trap.
It's a trap. It's a trap.
That's no moon.
That's no moon.
It's yeah.
a space station.
So we're going to go way back when to 2008. Yes.
Ah, yes.
2008. Mm-hmm. This is...
This one.
This was right before... for Michelle Obama kind of disappeared from the campaign trail for Barack Obama running for president.
Yes.
And many people like myself theorize that maybe it's because of what she said here in Puerto Rico.
I mean, you can't have somebody on the campaign trail giving away the end game.
The underlying... game of everything. But yeah, this is what she said. Hopefully it plays out enough.
And Barack knows that we are going to have to make sacrifices. We are going to have to change our conversation. We're going to have to change our traditions, our history. We're going to have to move into a different place as a nation to provide the kind of future that we all want desperately for our children. And he is the man to do it.
All right. Yeah, we have to change our traditions.
Change our history.
Our history.
Oh, you're taking that out of context.
Well, the context right before that is she's talking about kids. We'll share the link of the whole thing. And by the way, finding this, you can't just Google Michelle Obama, change our traditions.
Well, you can if you don't use Google.
Yes.
If you use a different search engine, it's like the first or second thing that pops up.
Right. If you use Google search,
you cannot find this.
Change our traditions. You'll find a link to, I think it was Glenn Beck and when he was back with Fox News and...
quoting this.
Yeah. It has video begins, what we saw. Video ends, and what she said is in between those things in the transcript. If you actually want to find it, you have to go somewhere, some other search engine, search it, and it's one
duck,
or two
duck,
on the list.
Go or dog pile dog piles. Or literally anywhere.
Some smaller company that's not Google. Trying to get all of your, not trying to mine your data. So yeah. So why would that be important today to go way back when to 2008? Change our traditions, change our history. Why?
Well, because that's kind of what they're doing.
Who? Right? Who's doing what?
Oh, who's, you know, Black Lives Matter and the politicians.
They're just helping justice for George Floyd and
tearing down the statues. Trying to, and
that's all because
I mean I'm not really sad about Roosevelt going system. Away, but the other ones are.
It's you know, depressing. I find it interesting. I know why, but I find it interesting that the line for Donald Trump was Andrew Jackson. Arguably the most racist president we've ever had. And that's saying something because a couple weeks ago we covered Woodrow
Wilson.
Statues,
one of the statues I'm not particularly upset that it's going away, but... I am upset that it's going away because it doesn't matter that the man was actually a monster. It matters that it is our history. It's history. It's part of our history, and you shouldn't destroy that.
Yeah, it's ugly, though. It's ugly history.
Well, so are you, but that makes no difference.
Yeah, how are you supposed to learn from the ugly parts of history if you don't know what it is?
Are you saying you never had an ugly math teacher?
I'm not saying I've had gorgeous math teachers.
Just saying. That was... What would that even be?
Yeah.
It's because it's a course in school. Is it coursist? Is that what I am now?
Coursist?
Because it was specifically math teachers that I singled out. academiaist?
speaking of, I told my wife I think I'm subconsciously sexist towards female math teachers.
Oh, yeah? Why is that?
Every female math teacher I've had, except for one, and the one was a machinist that knew how to apply math in basically every practical sense. But every female math teacher I had going through school, even in college, I did terrible in the class. Not because I didn't understand the concepts or anything, because I did. I just did terrible in the class. I didn't turn in assignments. I didn't.
Just was it because you were distracted or?
No, they. That math book was real pretty.
That's terrible.
So, yeah. It's just that group so far that I've noticed.
That's what I had. Who did I even have? I don't even remember my math teachers. They were that forgettable.
That forgettable.
I only remember two of my math teachers. One of them was my geometry teacher, because she was actually pretty awesome. The other one was my algebra teacher, who I swear she would read the lesson as she was teaching it to us, because nobody knew what she was talking about. Just, and I'm pretty sure she didn't either.
All right, if you turn to page 5 and follow along.
Okay, and I swear on a, like, I almost got sent to the principal's office this one time for mouthing off. Imagine
you
me
mouthing
off, right?
Please. Yeah.
So she gets up and she writes out this big equation. Like, she's going on this equation for like 10 minutes in my math class. And she's writing it up here on the chalkboard and whatever. And she gets to a point and she stops and she turns around and she says, "So what's my sign?" And the class goes dead quiet because everybody had zoned out and nobody knew what she was even talking about.
No one was enthralled with the writings in the math book.
Me in the corner, you know, brain, mouth, no filter in between. It's the big square one that says I'm stupid. Dead quiet in the classroom, and I said that, and somehow she either didn't hear me or chose to ignore me. And as the rest of the class busts up laughing, one kid graciously answered, because it was like a 50-50 shot. It's either a negative or a positive. There's only two things that this could be, so he just took, it's negative? Yes! And she kept going. And I got off the hook, and it was great. But yeah, that was one of my finest moments in algebra.
So everyone paid attention to that class, much like everyone paid attention in history class, apparently.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I was a TA for a history class, so.
Ba-dum-bum.
That wasn't a joke. It was real. I was a teacher's aide. It was glorious.
I don't doubt that.
It's one of my favorite classes.
Great.
He taught it well. It's good. Anyway.
It's good.
She's probably part of the reason why I enjoy doing this podcast.
So, you know, we got all these statues being torn down because, you know, they're racist or whatever. I don't even know. Well, I do know, but yeah. And it's not because of racism.
Isn't it, though?
Change our
but
history.
But they were all slave owners.
Change our traditions. Change our
which makes them racist.
So I thought, you know, maybe we can replace them with some statues that are, you know, didn't like slavery and fought against it. You know, statues of those kinds of people, right?
Oh, right.
That should be a good replacement.
Oh, okay. So you have a list of potential candidates here?
I have some candidates here. Okay. This person, for example. "I abhor slavery. I was born in a country where slavery had been established by British kings and parliaments, as well as by the laws of the country ages before my existence. In former days, there was no combating the prejudices of men supported by interests. The day I hope is approaching when, from principles of gratitude as well as justice, every man will strive to be foremost in showing his readiness to comply with the golden rule. Do unto others as others will do unto you." Blah, blah, blah. Seems like that'd be a fitting type of candidate there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, who said that? Was it Barack Obama?
That was Henry Lawrence.
Oh.
Mm.
Oh. Okay.
You might know him. Or you might not, because nobody teaches founding history really anymore in schools, unless you go specifically to a school that focuses on that. He was once the president of Congress. So, yeah. Another one. Prior to the Great Revolution, the great majority of our people had been so long accustomed to the practice and convenience of having slaves that very few among them even doubted the propriety and rectitude of it. So he's, this gentleman was thinking that it was just so commonplace, nobody thought of how wrong it was. Meaning, he thought it was wrong. John Jay, mm-hmm. another founder. Let's see. This person went on to help form an abolitionist group. One of the first ones, actually, in the United States.
Right.
And he said, a disposition to abolish slavery prevails in North America, that many of Pennsylvanians have set their slaves at liberty, and that even the Virginia Assembly have petitioned the king for permission to make law for preventing the importation of more into that colony. This request, however, will probably not be granted, as their former laws of that kind have always been repealed.
Well, and anybody that knows American history around the time of the founding, and specifically in the area of Pennsylvania, might be able to guess who said this.
What would your guess be?
Pennsylvania.
You probably have it pulled up, don't you?
I definitely have it pulled up. Pennsylvania, the 1700s, late 1700s, Benjamin Franklin, maybe?
Yes, sir. And here's something interesting from that. So he mentioned, we'll get back to this, but he mentions, Virginia has been constantly trying to get laws passed to stop importation of slavery. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's not ending the practice of slavery, I know, but they're trying to take a step here of, hey, can we stop shipping slaves to Virginia, to the colonies? So we'll get back to that because of a few other quotes later that I want to point out. Another person, this person was known as the Hellhound of Abolition. That's quite the nickname to have, I would think.
Well, I mean, if you know anything about the man, Hellhound's a great description of him.
He was no quiet person. This quote's really long, but I'll just leave it with that nickname because pretty much that's all you need on the plaque. John Quincy Adams.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've heard of him before. His name is on these documents behind me. Yeah, it goes on and on. We'll share this list.
There's so many. We'll just share the link to this. Because there's...
And on and on and on and on and on.
And on and on and on and on. Yep.
Now, specifically Virginia, because there's a couple of founders there whose statues and edifices of sorts were defaced. Let's see.
You want this one from El Presidente himself?
Yeah, go ahead.
So, finally prohibited slavery in Virginia, George Washington stated this:
mm-hmm.
"I can only say that there is not a man living who wishes more sincerely than I do to see a plan adopted for the abolition of slavery." He said "of it," meaning slavery,
referring to
slavery. That was when they first started talking about slavery prohibition.
Right. We did this, was it 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago? We kind of covered this. And
it's like 4 or 5 weeks ago now, dude.
And here we are. And it's way too easy to predict what's going on.
It really is.
It's like a book. It's like reading a book.
Cromwell, you magnificent bastard, I read your book!
It's like reading a book with these people.
It is like reading a book.
A short picture book.
With lots of pictures.
Lots of pictures.
Lots of pictures.
But yeah, Jefferson also lived in Virginia, also influenced laws in Virginia, wrote in the rough draft of the Constitution, one of the grievances for going to for separating from the king was he's waged a cruel war against human nature itself, violating its most sacred rights of life and liberty in the persons of a distant people who never offended him, captivating and carrying them into slavery in another hemisphere or to incur miserable death in the transportation thither. Determined to keep open a market where men should be bought and sold, he has prostituted his negative for suppressing every legislative attempt to prohibit or to restrain this execrable commerce. Yeah. But, you know, let's deface his statues, tear down his statues, because he owned slaves.
You know, it's really kind of disgusting when you dig into the history of the Founding Fathers and, you know, these people painting them now as these awful racist slave owners and all this stuff, and how many of them were very outspoken against that.
Well, then why'd they do the three-fifths clause if they were only three-fifths of a person?
Because it was a step in a direction. You
know? It couldn't have anything. It couldn't have anything to do with population count, so that the South didn't have more politicians than the North. It couldn't have anything to do with
you
that.
You know, it couldn't possibly be anything like gerrymandering. Like
it couldn't have anything to do with you had to own property to vote, and so if slaves are recognized as
so
people,
many,
they could own property and they could vote. It couldn't have anything to do with that.
So many things. But, I mean, you look at this list of quotes, and it's John Adams, Samuel Adams, Charles Carroll, John Dickinson, Benjamin Franklin.
You keep saying all these names, but who
John
are they?
Jay. Every one of these these ones that I just listed most of them were original signers of the Constitution. John Jay was the president of the Continental Congress. You have Richard Henry Lee was also a president of the Continental Congress and a signer of the Declaration. Richard Henry Lee was a signer of the Declaration and a framer of the Bill of Rights. William Livingston was a signer of the Constitution and governor of New Jersey. You have Luther Martin, delegate at Constitution Convention. George Mason, delegate at Constitutional Convention. Joseph Reed, revolutionary officer and governor of Pennsylvania. Benjamin Rush was a signer of the Declaration.
Probably my second favorite, third favorite. He's up there.
Founder of the Pennsylvania Abolition Society and president of the National Abolition Movement. Noah Webster was responsible for Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution.
Who's Webster? Who's Noah Webster? Who
I just
the
told
heck
you.
Is he? Yeah, but it's not like there's this giant... You know, but
I forgot to bring it, dang James, it. James Wilson was a signer of the Constitution and one of the first U.S. Supreme Court justices. John Witherspoon, another signer of the Declaration. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. Numerous people that signed our Declaration. This glorious piece of parchment on the wall behind us over here. They signed that document, and they were, at heart, abolitionists. They believed in freedom.
Yeah, but still, George Washington owned slaves.
Yes, and he also set them free when he died.
Yeah, when he died. Not while he was alive.
Okay, but you like look at the history of it. Look at the laws of it. Like you got to understand the context. Could not set them free until he died. It was in his will to let them go.
And yes, he did purchase slaves only once.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's like, "What the heck am I doing?"
and he had what was his name?
He lost money from his slaves because he didn't work them.
Right. Well, I was talking about the boy that he had that he left.
William.
Yeah. You know, he left enough for William to be taken care of for the rest of his life.
He debatably got more than Washington's actual descendants got in the will.
you know, and they're tearing down Washington's statues, saying he's a racist. What kind? What the f*** is that?
Oh, jeez.
Sorry.
Angry.
I've had it up to here, man. I just up to I've had it up to here.
It's about the between his eyebrows and the top of his head is where he had his hand. Up to there.
I was just right over the top of my mic.
Well, your head was up there too.
My head was in the way. I've had it up to here.
Yeah.
I'm about up to the top. It's gonna explode any minute now.
Yeah. And with the three-fifths thing, you really have to look at everything going on around there, not just, well, they're three-fifths of the person. Well, yeah, because the South just argued before that they're property.
Yeah.
And then...
It's a step in a direction.
And then they and then they got to, okay, we need to figure out how many representatives get sent to Congress, because they had the Senate all figured out. Everyone gets two. No matter who you are, everyone gets two.
Everybody gets two.
That makes the small states happy. The bigger states with higher population, like, hey, we need to be representative because we have more people. True. All right. So based off your population, you get this many people per this many people. You get a representative per this many people. And then the South is like, oh, sweet. So we got like 20 representatives each state. And the North was like, no, you don't. What do you mean, no, you don't? We have this many people here. Are your slaves property or are they people?
Right.
Because if they're people...
Then you have to let them go.
We the people. Huh. It's like, well, no. And so the North was like... they pretty much, the North did some math. Like, all right, if we give them three-fifths.
It'll please them, and they still won't get the majority vote.
Almost. Almost as many as us, but we still have more.
Mm-hmm.
So we can fix it later?
Yeah,
we can
fix it later. Thank heaven for that.
So they did that. You can't have both. They're either property or they're people. And if they're property, they don't count. Mm-hmm. North called him on it right away. So, yeah.
Not to say that it was right, but...
It was incredible foresight.
Yes, it was.
Instead of just caving, like, okay, yeah. Because if they caved and gave them full vote, gave them full count on population, any idea the South came up with would have been done.
Mm-hmm.
Up to the Civil War, which probably never would have happened because the South would have been dominating the policies of everything.
Right.
So, yeah. Anyway. Just some ideas for some replacement statues. A few ideas. Shall we...
Several of those would be replacing statues of themselves. Just saying. So, but what is causing all of this, though? Like, what ideals is it that drives people to do this kind of crap?
Marxism.
What is this?
Comrades.
Welcome.
Comrades.
I know what this song is, but I don't know this song.
It's really good when the beat drops.
That's coming up. Here it goes.
Yeah. All right, that's good. That's enough comedy. I am the law.
Gosh.
Let's take a break, then we'll talk about that. Because,
yeah, right. Here we go.
Yeah.
I am in no way a soda-holic.
No way a soda-holic. Dr. Pepper, if you ever do catch wind of our podcast, we will happily accept Dr. Pepper as...
as a sponsor.
As a sponsor. And you can pay us with Dr. Pepper, and that'd be fine.
I was going to say, considering that I probably single-handedly keep your diet soda in circulation.
The history of Dr. Pepper is fantastic.
Mm. We might have to cover that at some point.
It's a Texas original.
Mm. Mm-hmm. It makes me like it even more.
Yes. And they had a great ad campaign at one point of have a Dr. Pepper. Like, they had a time each day that you should have a Dr. Pepper to keep you active and healthy.
Oh, yeah?
It was like every
5 minutes starting from the time you wake up?
It was like 10 o'clock and noon and 2 o'clock and 3:30.
Hey, you know what? I drink a Dr. Pepper at each and every one of those times every day.
Every day.
And also several times in between those times.
Several
every times. Every day. Yeah. So, back to...
back to our comrades.
Oh.
So, we need to start... if you've never read the Communist Manifesto, which is Manifesto of the Communist Party, however you want to say the title, you should. We'll have a link to it in our little stuff. I'll admit I haven't read the whole thing, but I read enough to make sure what we're about to share is actually there.
I was able to make it through the first, 25 pages out of 68.
So halfway there.
Halfway. That was 3 years ago. I haven't been able to make myself read it again.
There's so much
stuff. So much there. So much. And it's like, if you really understand what they're talking about, it's really painful to read. Because
while I was in college, I took a philosophy class. One of the more interesting philosophers was Karl Marx. Just seeing how he came to his decisions of his philosophy and all this stuff, it was interesting. Agree with it? Absolutely not.
Give me that.
But it's an interesting one to study, and you should study. Because that's what's going on everywhere. Don't believe me? We'll share some evidence. I've got a little list here. The 10 planks quote of the Communist Manifesto. So these are 10 points that are in chapter 2 of the Manifesto of the Communist Party. It was written by Karl Marx and... I just forgot his name. I basically have it right there. I forgot the guy's name. Frederick Engels. Also a very interesting person to study. Anyway, we're going to go through these lists. And off the top of your head, if you can think of anything that matches this that's happened in the United States, let me know, Mike.
Sure, I can think of all kinds of things that match all these things.
Number the first, abolition of property in land and application of all rents of land to public purpose.
Wait, what?
So, it essentially, private property gone.
Oh, so you mean like we can buy the property, but we still have to pay to live there?
Yeah.
And if we do something that somebody doesn't like, they can take it away from us?
Yeah.
You mean like property taxes?
No, that's the price for being a citizen.
That's the price for being a citizen, for living in a...
For a civilized
society. For owning
society.
Property in a...
Yeah.
In a city or town or state or...
Right.
Right.
That keeps you safe.
Oh, it does.
Yes.
Okay, so that's not what it's talking about.
No. Yes.
You sure? you positive? Don't you still have to pay property tax every year after you outright own the house?
Yes.
Okay. It's so you're renting the property from the city or state or country. You don't actually own it.
But you own it, though.
But you still have to pay them to live there.
You have the deed, so you
own
it.
What happens if you stop paying them?
Then, you know, we got to collect the taxes somehow, so.
So you take the property. But what gives you the right to take the property if I own the property?
You got to pay.
Oh, okay. So it's like I don't own the property. I'm just renting it from you.
Yes, but you own it.
Oh, okay.
But you own it.
Gotcha. Makes sense. Yeah. Makes perfect sense if you don't think about it.
So
I lost my lid.
So as a heads up here too. This was written in 1847.
Right.
Okay. This was 1847 is when this was written. When do you think property tax first appeared?
I don't know. I used to know this date, but I can't remember off the top of my head. I'll take a wild guess. 1852.
Technically, it started at the beginning of the country. 1797 was the first time.
Really?
It appeared. It was an estate tax. But that was specifically to fund the U.S. Navy that did not exist at all.
Right.
And then they took it away.
But existing as it does now.
Existing as it does now, 1916.
Oh, I was way off.
Something about progressive era.
Oh, right.
Something, I don't know.
Oh, doesn't that tie into the next plank of?
Heavy progressive or graduated income tax.
Huh.
Huh.
Huh. Right.
Well, that's the price for living in a civilized society.
So does that...
Because you worked really hard.
You worked really hard, so you should pay us for working really hard.
So we're going to take some of that hard work that you did for yourself and keep it for ourselves.
Oh, they don't redistribute it? I thought they redistributed.
Well, I mean, we have some programs that help keep you safe for the children.
So, yeah, there's that.
When do you think income tax started? Before or after?
You would ask me all kinds of questions. I don't know the answer. Oh, but it was just a before or after? You're giving me a multiple choice now?
Yeah, I'll give you that now.
I'm like, you didn't give me enough time to study all this. I don't have the answers in the
You
top
said
my
you looked this at is, the email.
I did look at the email while I was sitting in my truck in the middle of a job site in Tooele.
Mm. It's Tooele. Ugh. There's nothing there. You should have had plenty of time. It's not the end of the world, but you can see it from there.
But see, that's why I was at a job site there, is because we were making things there, so.
All right, I'll allow it.
Because unlike most government work, I actually contribute to society.
Yeah. income tax started in 1913, progressive era.
Wait, wasn't that about the same time that the property tax started? So they started stealing all of my money at the same time. That's bastards.
Abolition of all rights of inheritance.
Oh, well, this one hasn't happened yet.
No, it hasn't happened at all, and that there's a death tax or anything like that.
Right, yeah, but people still have the right to get things from their dead
relatives.
So
long as you pay the inheritance tax.
Right, but you still get some of... It's not all of the inheritance that they've taken away. It's only some of it.
Yeah. 1862, I believe, is what I'm seeing there.
For the death tax?
For when that started, the inheritance tax or estate tax. Right. That was also after 1847.
It's almost as if somebody's been using this as a, like, outline for a strategy of some variety.
Federally, though, it's, 1862, 90 years old. Federally. Cool. confiscation of the property of all immigrants and rebels.
That would never happen.
We would never
put anybody of a particular nationality into a concentration, internment camp.
I mean,
for any reason.
Never. We would never.
Of any kind.
We would never relocate.
In the middle of a war. And then maintain those rights and powers for the government afterwards. Yeah, we would never do something like that.
Okay, so number four hasn't happened yet.
At all.
Cool. Didn't happen during World War II.
Do you think they can tell I'm being sarcastic, or is that...
Am I
laying it on a little thick?
It did not happen during World War II after everyone got worried about Japanese people.
No.
Did not happen. Centralization of credit in the hands of the state by means of a national bank with state capital and an exclusive monopoly.
Oh, see, this would never happen.
Congress collects the money.
Right.
And distributes the money.
You know, there's no centralized thing that prints or does anything.
There's no reserve. There's no...
What is it? Modern monetization theory?
None of that is happening at all.
Huh.
None of that at all.
At all. Doesn't happen.
Nope. Let's see. Centralization of the means of communication and transport in the hands of the state.
So you mean, like, the... Like, UDOT and, you know...
No.
No, no, not no, like that.
No, okay. No.
I'm not talking about the
FCC.
The either. FCC no. Or no?
Or the FAA.
Not that. Or any of those things?
No, not talking about any of those things that are centralized.
But we need public transport. It's
we
important
need it.
For
it
poor
is
people
important
to get around.
That the state controls how people move around
right.
And how they talk to each other. It is very important that the state controls that for your safety and for the children.
Right, and for your convenience, so that the people that are less able can manage to get to places.
Right. Yes, around. For your safety right. And for your children.
Right,
and for exactly. The poor among us,
for the greater good.
The greater good.
It's for the greater good.
Yes, the greater good.
Mm-hmm. That's what it's always about.
It's always
about the greater good.
Always.
Never forget, we're doing this for the greater.
Remember,
good, Trevor.
When your ballot comes in the mail. Or you're at the voting booth, and it says a grant to build whatever school or road. Always check yes on that, because it absolutely will not ever, ever, ever raise your taxes. Never, ever.
And never forget that the politician you want in office is the one that's going to vote yes on the multi-trillion-dollar bills that will improve our lives.
And if you're not sure who that politician is... See if you recognize the name.
Yes.
And that will let you know that that's the politician that should stay there.
Exactly.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Wilhelm. Extension of factories and instruments of production owned by the state.
Perfectly pitched on that, too. That was good.
I've been practicing.
I can see that.
Extension of factories and instruments of production owned by the state, the bringing into cultivation of wastelands, and the improvement of the soil generally in accordance with a common plan.
So, like the Bureau of Land Management, there's a lot of things I see in here.
Housing and urban development.
Housing and urban development. You got the Bureau of Land Management, the wildlife resources, the...
National parks.
National parks.
National parks can also go up to number one.
That's true. That is true.
You know, you got to have public access to land. The general public can't just go anywhere. You got to have a designated place where they can go.
But the factories and instruments of production owned by the state, that's not a...
The Fed isn't buying up debts that factories happens. And things own.
I mean, and, you know, technically, like, prison labor wouldn't count for that.
No.
You know, that's not at all. That's not glorified slave labor at all.
No.
Dude, I actually saw a list of companies that use prison labor for their, like, means of production. It's actually pretty extensive. There's, like, a lot of them.
Apple?
I don't remember if
Apple was on. It may not be U.S. prisons, but Apple? Go ahead and tweet that out on your iPhone.
When he has a point, he has a point. I mean,
all this injustices. Tweet. It's Apple. I love my new iPhone.
Right.
Equal liability of all to labor. Establishment of industrial armies, especially for agriculture.
Well, that doesn't sound like unions or anything at all.
Nope. Okay, moving on. Okay. Combination of agriculture with manufacturing industries, gradual abolition of the distinction between town and country by a more
equitable distribution
of the population over the country.
Huh. So, you mean... Because, I mean, we shouldn't have the Electoral College because, you know, we're distributed well enough now that...
Yeah, it's pretty well even. Just
it's pretty well spread, even across the board.
Just spread like hot butter across that tasty toast of America. No need to... There's no little lumps lingering anywhere.
Yeah.
Free education for all children in public schools. Abolition of children's factory labor in its present form. Combination of education with industrial production. One thing on this list I agree with.
Wait a minute. What?
Abolition of children's factory labor in its present form, way back in 1847.
Yeah, that's true.
I'll agree with that.
I mean, as a kid that grew up and wanted a job when I was like 8, you know, willingly, if they want to work,
right?
Then let them do stuff for family, right. Whatever things like that.
That's why I say I agree with it in the present form.
In its present form, yes. Yeah, it definitely needed to go away in the form it had back then.
If you own your own business and your kid wants to work for you so he can have some spending money.
Right.
I don't see
why not teach him how to work?
Yeah.
That's child labor.
And making him do his laundry isn't?
Or chores of any kind?
Or mow the lawn?
Let's be honest.
Yeah.
Labor is a fact of life. They need to learn it at some point. Combination of education with industrial production. Now that one, I mean, I don't know where that one is in our society.
I'm trying to remember where it was.
I did find that list of companies that use prison labor, by the way, and it's like pretty much everybody.
Pretty much everybody.
Like, no, legit. Like, yeah. Like from like Boeing to like Wendy's, like it's everybody. Like, seriously. You got Microsoft, Starbucks, Walmart. I mean, nobody's surprised about Walmart. Victoria's Secret. Your $90 piece of lingerie. Yeah, it was made by a dude in prison for 49 cents.
Just found some string lying around and threw it together.
Yeah, right. Oh, what else we got here? We got Verizon, JCPenney, Sprint, Fruit of the Loom.
Man.
I'm not going to read that one out on air. Procter & Gamble, who owns Tide, Olay, and Pampers. Your diapers, made in prison, which makes a certain kind of sense.
Makes a certain kind of sense.
Johnson & Johnson, Neutrogena, Band-Aids, Splenda, baby oil.
All right.
I'm going to stop I'm reading this stuff.
It hurts. I wish I could find it, but there's a...
They do pay them, you know, 45, 50 cents an hour for that.
Oh, so they're getting paid, so it's fine.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Sure.
On top of the debt to society.
Oh, yes, of off. Course. You know, I mean, we're already paying for the room and board and whatever. Might and as well Xbox, give them a job to cable, have some TV, pocket change.
Whatever, food. Yeah, I was trying to find real quick another list of communist goals. Maybe you remember what it is, where it's at. But among that list is destroying the importance of art.
Oh.
All right, he's where I'm at least. So
yes, I'm exactly where you're at.
Oh, he's reading.
You continue on. I will find something.
Well, that's the thing. I don't know if I want to continue on without knowing exactly what I'm. We got this, people. We got this. Bear with us.
Are you sure? I don't know that Found I it. Have it. Did you get it?
45 declare goals. Why'd you do that? There we go. Nope.
Oh, maybe I made it further than I thought. I remember reading the Q&A in here, too.
Where's the original 45? There we go. I found it. It is, this was read in Congress. That's right. These are the 45 goals as read in Congress for communist takeover of America. All right. This is from the Naked Communist also. He, Cleon Skousen also puts this in his book, The Naked Communist. But yeah, it's 45 goals to change America. I'd love to go through all of them, but that'll take a while. U.S. acceptance of coexistence is the only alternative to atomic war. I don't know about you, but when I was in elementary school, kept getting this garbage crap of every U.S. city has a sister Russian city. Things like that.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, that was something like that. Because, you know, peace and everything. Let's hit a reset button.
Oh, no, that's not a thing that's happening right now.
U.S. willingness to capitulate in preference to engaging in atomic war, blah, 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 blah. This didn't happen 8 years before Donald Trump developed the illusion that total disarmament by the United States would be a demonstration of moral strength. That didn't occur.
There's that.
Permit free trade between all nations regardless of communist affiliation. Extension of long-term loans to Russia and Soviet satellites. Provide American aid to all nations, regardless of communist dominion. Domination.
No, we don't. We don't do. We are not the number one funders of the UN and the WHO and literally every other world organization that. Oh, wait,
well,
yes,
we're not the number one donors of WHO anymore. So there's that.
Score one score. For freedom.
1 for 99. Grant recognition of Red China. Admission of Red China to the UN. China's not in the UN, nor are they recognized as a country at all.
Yeah, no.
Wait.
Not at all.
Wait.
I mean, we don't have a whole pandemic thing on our hands right now because of I'm not going to go there.
Set up East and West Germany as separate states.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down that wall.
So we undid that one.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't matter. Allow all Soviet satellites individual representation in the UN. That never happened.
You know, I'm half afraid somebody's going to listen to this and be like, oh, we're in a good place then. Like, no, guys, we're being sarcastic. Yeah. Like, pretty much all of this has already happened. Yeah, we're already there.
If this was transcribed, the text would be like the SpongeBob meme where it's a mix of capital letters and lowercase letters. It's all sarcasm. That is how you properly write sarcasm on the paper.
Is that how you write? I've always wanted a sarcasm font. Maybe I'm going to start typing things that way now.
Yeah, that's how you do it. There was a...
I always just thought that was the "you're an idiot" font. My bad.
There's...
Oh.
How ironic. There's this thing I saw where some English major professor lady, whatever. Excuse me. Ooh, goodness. Said that one of the major problems with U.S. language is it can't... you can't write sarcasm. To which just about every response underneath her thing was people taking exactly what she said and doing it in the SpongeBob capital letter, lowercase letter.
Oh, gosh. That's awesome.
Here's one. Promote the UN as the only hope for mankind. If its charter is rewritten, demand that it be set up as a one-world government with its own independent armed forces.
Why do conservatives keep saying get out of the UN? Why do they keep saying that?
Dude, Kung Flu is trending right now.
Good. Good.
Oh, that's great. I've been waiting for this. And it's trending as everybody's calling it a slur. Like, you're making it trend by talking against it. Oh, gosh, that's great. Thank you for that. Made my night.
I sent you the links if you want to follow along where I'm at.
Okay.
Let's see. Going down to number 12. Yeah. This is going to be another two-part episode. Thanks, Marxism.
Right.
Thank you. And we haven't even gotten to why we're talking about all this.
Oh, gosh. Yeah, I mean, this...
Way down at the bottom.
Way down at the bottom. Yeah. Number 12 is down at the bottom?
Well, he does some highlighted ones, then he puts full list down at the bottom.
Ah, is that where it's at? Okay, let's go quick.
Yep. Number 12, resist any attempt to outlaw the Communist Party.
I mean, he couldn't outlaw it in a free country anyway.
Technically,
but,
no, but...
do away with all loyalty oaths. You mean, like, you know, praying and, you know, the Pledge of Allegiance. And
yeah, we don't need that in our schools.
Don't need that in our schools.
Continue giving Russia access to the U.S. Patent Office. Why?
Oh, here we go. This one's good. Capture one or both of the political parties in the United States. Oh,
good thing none of those parties have been taken over.
Yeah, it's a all great thing have. that no party in our U.S. politics has got any influence from Russia at all.
Zero.
Or any of the communist Marxist countries across the world.
Speaking of, those of you that hate the Democrats, hate the Republicans, hate both, hate any political party, maybe you should build a statue to George Washington who said, don't do political parties before he left office.
There's that. this one's fun, too. Use technical decisions of the courts to weaken basic American institutions by claiming their activities violate civil rights.
Well, good thing that's never happened, because bakers can still bake whatever cake they want.
It is good that bakers can still bake... Wait, were you being sarcastic again?
Get control of the schools. Use them as transmission belts for socialism and current communist propaganda. Soften the curriculum. Get control of teachers' associations. Put the party line in textbooks.
This one is horrifying because there is actually a ex-KGB operative who did a whole little interview back in the 80s.
Oh, the Canadian defector?
Yes.
Defected to Canada,
yes. Yes, exactly. He defected to Canada, and he did this whole little spiel, and he said that the very first step that they needed to do in order to create a revolution that would lead to Marxism in the United States was to indoctrinate the new generations, which he said would take about 15 years of this exact thing, controlling the schools, softening the curriculum, destroying our history piece by piece.
Well, that's just a conspiracy, says the brainwashed person.
No, of course. It's,
says the person that just spent all just their last conspiracy. 20 years in that system.
Use student riots to foment public protests against programs or organizations which are under communist attack. This doesn't sound like anything that's been Antifa.
That didn't. None of that happened in California years ago.
Oh yeah, no, that didn't happen at all.
That's not happening
right now.
That's not at all how Mao Zedong started his rise to power.
Yeah.
Infiltrate the press. Get control of book review assignments, editorial writing, policy making positions. One of my favorite things. Well, they attend a peer review survey. There's a couple of guys that took Mein Kampf, changed words to make it politically correct, and it was accepted as a peer-reviewed thing.
Dude.
Gain control of all student newspapers. Oh, I went up, but yeah.
Well, let's blaze through these real quick, because we got to get moving on. Yes, so we do. I'll just pop through them real quick, and if you want to add something, just stop me.
Okay. Make sure you do 26. That's all I'm asking right now.
Oh, I know,
right? We're going to make
we got this. Okay. Gain control of key positions in radio, TV, and motion pictures.
Doesn't happen.
Continue discrediting American culture by degrading all forms of artistic expression. An American communist cell was told to eliminate all good sculptures from parks and buildings, substitute shapeless, awkward, and meaningless forms.
Well, that's good thing there's not a banana on display at high-end institutes of arts.
Right. Control art critics and directors of art museums. Our plan is to promote ugliness, repulsive, meaningless art. Eliminate all laws governing obscenity by calling them censorship and a violation of free speech and free press. Break down cultural standards of morality by promoting pornography and obscenity in books, magazines, motion pictures, radio, and TV. We haven't seen that degradation at all. Present homosexuality, degeneracy, and promiscuity as normal, natural, and healthy.
But it is.
Oh, it is.
It is. Love
such a
wins.
Infiltrate the churches and replace revealed religion with social religion. Discredit the Bible and emphasize the need for intellectual maturity, which does not need a religious crutch. Eliminate prayer or any phase of religion expression in the schools on the ground that it violates the principle of separation of church and state.
Mm. Yeah, because that shows up in...
When did this get read in... Because...
You would ask that.
I would ask that. You go find that. I'm going to keep going.
1963
is when it was read. Wow. Discredit the American Constitution by calling it inadequate, old-fashioned, out of step with modern needs, a hindrance to cooperation between nations on a worldwide basis, and I would add racist.
Never heard any of those arguments about the Constitution.
Discredit the American founding fathers. Present them as selfish aristocrats who had no concern for the common man, and I would add again, racist.
We just... went through that, and we didn't have this as part of our prep.
We are on number 30 right now, and I haven't seen a single one of these that hasn't happened already. Discredit the American... belittle all forms of American culture and discourage the teaching of American history on the grounds that it was only a minor part of the big picture. Give more emphasis to Russian history since the communists took over. Which, that hasn't happened as much because... But,
well, I mean,
you know, China.
I mean, to whatever. Be fair, you don't really hear much about Russian history pre-Bolsheviks.
That's true, too. Support any socialist movement to give centralized control over any part of the culture, education, social agencies, welfare programs, mental health clinics, etc.
Eliminate all laws or procedures which interfere with the operation of the communist apparatus. That doesn't happen.
And eliminate the House Committee on Un-American Activities.
This hasn't happened at all. Number 35.
Wait, we had a committee on Un-American Activities?
No. The one I'm about to say. This one hasn't happened in the slightest, not even the last couple of months. Discredit and eventually dismantle the FBI.
And police. Huh. Infiltrate and gain control of more unions. Infiltrate and gain control of big businesses. Facebook, Google, blah, blah, blah. Transfer some of the powers of arrest from the police to social agencies. You mean like having social workers go to 911 calls instead of police officers? Treat all behavioral problems as psychiatric disorders, which no one but psychiatrists can understand or treat.
Well, yeah, he killed those people because he's mentally insane. Yeah,
exactly. Dominate the psychiatric profession and use mental health laws as a means of gaining coercive control over those who oppose communist goals.
We need to get rid of guns because mental health.
Discredit the family as an institution, encourage promiscuity and easy divorce. That's not happening. Huh. Emphasize the need to raise children away from the negative influence of parents. I see this all the time.
Well, parents just don't know how to actually raise their children what they really need.
Create the impression that violence and insurrection are legitimate aspects of the American tradition. Oof. 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 Overthrow all colonial governments before native populations are ready for self-government.
Huh.
Huh. Internationalize the Panama Canal.
Huh.
Repeal the Connolly Reservation so the United States cannot prevent the World Court from seizing jurisdiction over domestic problems. Give the World Court jurisdiction over nations and individuals alike.
Huh. Yeah. Good thing.
45 points. I mean, how many of those have we not seen yet? Just a quick question on that.
Well,
I mean, the World Court doesn't have jurisdiction over
all right, so,
our stuff yet.
So carry the one. One.
One. There's one. There is one out of 45.
That hasn't happened that in hasn't any happened way, shape, yet. Or form.
Wow.
Mm. Cool. Yeah. Well,
you know.
Yeah. So, why? And we'll answer that next.
After the break.
Yeah. This will be a two-parter.
Yeah.
So, bye until the next part, which we're about to do.
Bye till part two. Don't minimize the little camera.
No.
It will go away and you will not be able to see yourself again.
Will not be able to see it.
There will be no video of your face.
None.
None.
None. Nine.
Nine. Nine videos of your face?
Nine videos of your face.